Assalamu alaikum. This is the first presentation of a series of presentations on basic surgical skills that I hope and the young surgeons and junior trainees will find useful. I also hope that the more senior surgeons will find it refreshing. We start today with the surgical needles. What are the bases on which you would choose a particular needle for a particular surgical task? In real life, you will be faced with situations like this. In this scenario, you have different types of tissues with different healing properties and different tissue strength, including the trachea when you are fashioning the tracheostome, and the repair of the stomach that has been pulled up into the neck in order to bridge the gap between the new pharynx and the gut. Different types of skin, including facial skin, neck skin, and chest skin, muscle tissue, and subcutaneous tissues. And you also may be faced with a situation like this when tissues are infected because of disruption of the repair line for the neopharynx. You could see the nasogastric tube here. You need also different types of needles to repair the pharynx that has inflamed edges and to repair the neck skin. So there is no such thing like what is the best surgical needle. Different needles are designed to perform different surgical tasks, and the best needle to perform one task should be different from the other. But these are the properties shared by all the good quality needles that we use in our surgical practice. They are made up of high quality stainless steel alloys, and they are almost always coated with a material like silicon. And this combined effect would provide enough strength to the needle structure to be sharpened enough to penetrate the tissues with minimal resistance, and also allows us the needle to be as slim as possible to prevent damage during gliding through tissues. Needles should be rigid in order to prevent bending while it is facing resistance. But more importantly, they should be ductile, and a ductile needle is the needle that's going to bend before it breaks. So that will provide an early warning to the surgeon that this needle is not appropriate for the task being done. Needles should be stable in their needle holders to allow precise placement of the needle point and the place the needle and prevent rocking. And that is usually provided by special design in the needle itself. And needles should also be sterile and corrosion resistant to avoid any deposition of foreign body particles in the wound. Almost all surgical needles are now provided covered with a very thin, a micro-thin coating of silicone or something similar. This improves very much the ease of penetration of the needle into the tissues. It reduces very much the force required to perform the initial penetration into the tissues, and also the gliding force that is required to pass the needle through the deeper structures. Needles need to be very sharp in order to reduce the force required for the initial penetration into the tissue, and also to reduce the amount of damage into the penetrated tissue, and that would decrease the amount of scarring. Sharpness is proportional to the ratio between the length of the pointing tip and its thickness. In order to achieve a high sharpness and to increase this ratio, we need very strong material here of particular stainless steel alloys, and also the coating to avoid damage to the very thin pointed point. There will be situations when the surgeon will feel that he needs to apply too much force in order to penetrate tissues. This obviously depends on the amount of resistance offered by the tissues to penetration, the type of the needle used, and its sharpness. Sharpness may be reduced by repeated passage of the needle through tough tissues. If this sensation is called the surgical yield point, And it's at this point that the surgeon would need to think about changing the needle to a tougher needle or a sharper needle, because needle passed by too much force through too high resistance may bend, and if the bending is beyond this point, the yield point of 10 to 30 degrees, then it becomes useless. And any attempts at reshaping the needle by correcting the bend can decrease its resistance or break the needle as well. So if you get to this point when you feel that there's too much resistance and you need to apply higher force, the surgical yield point needles need to be changed. Ductility refers to the physical property of the needle, which allows it to bend first before it breaks. The last thing you want is a needle breakage in a deep wound in which you would have to spend time and effort trying to retrieve the missing bits. You can minimize the amount of force applied on a needle to avoid bending and breakage if you use the needle in the proper way, along its curvature, applying the force along the curvature of the needle rather than just pushing it, and also applying the force with no angulation to the needle. Needles differ in their design and also in the materials used and the coating. Generally speaking, there are 9 aspects to the geometry of the needle. Starting from the point, which is the sharpened end of the needle, the point can be blunt, can be sharpened point like a troker, it can be triangular cutting knife, looking upwards in conventional needle or looking downwards in reverse cutting needles. The point is the part of the needle extending from the maximum diameter till the very end. The body of the needle itself differs between a needle and another in the amount of curvature, the thickness of the body, which is called the needle diameter, and its shape. It may be rounded, or it may be triangular, or it may be rectangular or flat. And then there is the last segment of the needle is usually flattened to allow secure placement of the needle holder. This is the holding segment, and it may be also rigged to allow higher resistance to the movement of rocking movement of the needle holder. And then the eye of the needle, which is the point at which the suture is attached to the needle itself. We'll come to this one by one, but that's the general aspects of the needle geometry. There is also the curvature and the size of the needle, which is dependent on its thickness, that is the diameter of the material in the body, and the curvature is the radius of the needle itself. The chord is the length, the distance between the eye of the needle and its tip, and the length of the needle is the whole length of the needle curvature from the eye till the very tip. Needles' eye are almost always now achromatic, like this one. There are several types of needles' eye, where we stopped to use the regular eye in which you would have to thread the suture inside the needle by either the surgeon or the scrub nurse. There are more elaborate designs for the eye, like having a spring eye or a double spring eye. But again, threading sutures and side needles are becoming extremely rare nowadays. You can have a rolled end eye in which the suture is secured in the needle by clamping the last bit of the eye, but most needles are now provided achromatic, with making a small hole by laser in the needle eye and then threading the suture inside and securing it by glue. Needles need to be secured and very stable within the jaws of the needle holder in order to allow for the precise placement of the needle tip into the tissues. If needles are not stable enough, then the tip of the needle may start twisting or rocking when it is facing resistance, and this will cause extra damage to the tissues being penetrated. In order to provide stability of the needle, a part of the needle body is flattened and perhaps grooved or ribbed to allow a secure placement within the jaws of the needle holder. And needle holders are also grooved to provide interlocking with this part of the needle body. Or sometimes the needle holders are surface are covered with carbide particles to increase the resistance to rocking or slippage of the needle within the jaws of the needle holder. It's important to know here that the initial part of the needle, the first 1/4 to 1/3 of the needle, is the weakest part of the needle itself, because it is hollowed to allow the threading of the suture inside. So just a thin shell of the stainless steel alloy around the thread. And this is the area that you should avoid catching with a needle holder in, because the needle may then break. You should never put the needle holder in the first third of the needle, because this is the weakest part of the needle. This is where most needles may break. The other important aspect of the needle's design is its geometry, the curvature of the needle. Probably the first needles were straight, and still in use, we still use straight needles to suture superficial structures like the skin or subcutaneous tissue, sometimes without a needle holder. Some of these needles had also got a small curve at the end to make a suturing process easier. We use smaller straight needles in otolaryngology, working within cavities like the nasal cavity. A small straight needle with the help of a needle holder can be used to suture nasal septal flaps or to secure nasal splints within the nasal cavity. But most needles are curved, some with a rather shallow curve, 1/4 of a circle. This type of a needle is the needle that you use in endoscopic surgery or microvascular anastomosis or anastomosis of nerve branches or grafts. But it is the 3/8 and the half circle curvature that are more in use for skin closure, subcutaneous tissue closure, or superficial structures in general. You can use either the 3/8 or the half circle. If you are working in deeper cavities, then you need more curvature so that you could recognize and spot the tip of the needle after it passes within the cavity. So you can use a 5/8 needle, or you can use a J-shaped needle for the same purpose. It's easier to identify the tip of a curved needle within a cavity. And there are some specially designed compound needles that combine the properties of different curvature. You can have a more steep curvature at the tip to make identification of the tip easier in some deeper cavities. The needle point is the part of the needle from its very tip to the maximum diameter of the body of the needle. So it's not actually a point, it's a segment of the needle, the distal segment of the needle. And sometimes the point extends to almost 1/3 or 1/4 of the needle, and sometimes it's just the very end of the needle. All this part of the needle is called the point. Some points are blunt if you don't need any cutting or any sharpening of the nasal tip to pass into friable tissue or tissues like the liver or the kidneys, and then you have a blunt end, a blunt point. But other needles are sharpened needles, and the sharpening can have one point like a trocar, or 2 points like a knife, or 3 points like triangular or spatula with 4 cutting points. We'll come to this one by one. And generally speaking, needles can be classified into blunt or cutting needles. And a blunt body needle can either have also a blunt point at the tip or can have a sharpened tapered point at the tip. So these are the two blunt needles. Cutting needles can either have conventional cutting edge. The conventional cutting edge is triangular in shape with its apex looking within the curvature of the needle, or it can have the apex the other way around, looking outside the curvature of the needle for the reverse cutting needles, or it can have only two cutting points like a slim blade used in some ophthalmology process, or it can have a combination of the taper point and the reverse cutting, like a taper cut with a pointed tip and a reverse cutting rest of the needle point. We'll come to these needles in a second. Needles differ not only in the way they perform the first penetration into the surface of the tissues, but also in the way they glide after this into the substance of the tissue itself. These are two separate functions. The initial penetration with the needle tip, and then the gliding of the whole of the needle after this through the substance of the tissues. And that's why different forms of needles have been developed. This is perhaps the most important bit of the needle design. Three features here of importance. The first one is the needle tip, the very last part of the needle itself. And the second is the needle body, the part of the needle with maximum diameter. This is the main body of the needle itself. It can take different shapes. And the whole area from the very last tip till the body is called the needle point. And this also can take different forms. So starting with the needle tip, it can be pointed like a troker, just a single point at the very tip, or it can be a slit, a vertical slit like a knife at the very tip of the needle, or it can be triangular like in other forms. The needle body also can take different forms. It can be rectangular if you just want to separate tissues without cutting through them, or it can still be a triangle if you want to continue the cutting process after the initial penetration into the substance of the tissue, or it can be a trapezoid, so it separates the substance of the tissue above and below, but it cuts sideways. The third feature, the needle point, the area from the tip to the main body, can also take different forms. If a needle is blunt, it is usually rounded, so it just dissects into the substance of the tissue without cutting through them. It minimizes the cutting of the needle after the initial penetration. Or it can be triangular. It continues to cut either to looking, the apex is looking inside the curvature of the needle in conventional needles, or the other way around in reverse cutting or the cutting edge. Or it can have features of several needles, like the taper point, which has a triangular tip, but also have a rounded point after this. So if you look into the blunt needles that dissect the substance of the tissue after the initial penetration, these two needles have rounded points. The last part of the needle is rounded, so it just dissects the tissues. But one of them has a very sharpened tip, and the other does not. For the cutting needles, you would have usually triangular in shape needle point with different directions of the triangle. And for the spatula needle that dissects the tissues up and below the needle, but cut sideways, you can have something like a trapezoid. So these are the bases, the different types of needle tips, needle points, and needle bodies. And we'll come to them one by one in the next presentation. So by this, we come to the end of this first presentation on the needle's design and the various features of the needle, including its tip, its point, its body, that forms the basis for selecting one needle rather than the other for to perform a particular task. We'll continue with which needle for which task in the next presentation.